I suppose I should say a word first. In 2011, I had the chance to go to Iceland, and I knew nothing about this country. I had learned one thing once while helping an engineer put together the kitchen cabinets for my sister's new house. We were smoothing out the IKEA diagrams, and the one thing Gardar said was that they had a museum. So I arrived thinking maybe there was an essay, and I had to go back because I realized there was a book. I started going in 2011, and it's been a few weeks or a few months, most years since then. Let me take you now. This is a museum sign in the landscape of Iceland. It takes you to a little family-run museum about shark, which are important. As my friend Lilia says, it is a terrible thing to do to anyone, but you are a tourist, so you must have the fermented shark. If you were here, you would have it before you went out drinking to coat your stomach. But now we won't even give you silverware to eat it with because it's hard to get the stench off the metal. There are a lot of museums in Iceland. It's actually astonishingly hard to figure out quite what the number is. This happens for a few reasons. One is that so many of them are coming into existence so quickly, right? The first museum in Iceland is established in the 1800s. It waits 80 years for the second. That second museum has a curator who will turn 100 years old in April and retired a couple of years ago thinking it was still probably too soon. So if we have the first collector of the second museum in Iceland, it points to just how recent this phenomenon is. Even when I was traveling in 2011, I noticed that almost everywhere I went, right, I went to 20 museums, and they'd all been founded since the year 2000, 1995 at the earliest. The 2014 spreadsheet by the museum studies professor in Iceland puts the number at 265 museums and public exhibitions. For a country that's now up to 365,000 people, right, a language spoken by only 500,000 people in the world, it's a lot. I want you to do the math of roughly one museum per 1,000 people. Think about where you live and how many museums you should have if you were trying to keep up with Iceland. I'm going to show you a fraction. We're just going to look at 20 signs of places you might go. You could visit the Sea Monster Museum in Bíldudalur. You could see a bunch of things that are actually really hard to see. One institution thinking about ghosts, elves, and the Northern Lights. There's a museum, there are a lot of museums in Iceland that talk about local history, maybe half of them. What the Icelanders sometimes call the same thing from 50 different farms. In this one, in Husavik, it also is home to what was at for a while the tallest man in the world. There is a museum dedicated to World War II, the occupation of Iceland by the British soldiers and then by the Americans did a lot to shape the place. This is a country that was one of the poorest places in Europe for most of the 1,000 years that it was inhabited, is still inhabited, of course. And they talk about, some people say, the thing that changed Iceland was the rubber boot. It was brought by the military forces, and imagine a people that farmed and fished for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years that had shoes that looked sort of like slippers, right, or made of seal skin or sheepskin, but just so little material because you know it's going to be sliced to tatters by walking the volcanic earth. Your journey could have been measured in how many pairs of shoes it was going to take you to get where you were going. And then the rubber boot. Fishermen coming home with dry toes for the first time in a millennium. They say that some people found it so disconcerting, just so absolutely alien, that they would pour a little bit of water in it to make it feel right. This is a museum by something of a one-hit wonder because He had some space in the lower flat of the house, and after his roommate moved out, thought, I don't need another roommate, and had a lot of memorabilia. The technical museum in the sort of north, slightly eastern part of Iceland, the location of the first transatlantic cable arriving, right? For a while, this was the hub of Iceland. All information came through it, and now it is barely reachable by road, the crisscrossiest set of switchbacks you've ever met to get down to it, and thank goodness you're trying to pass it during the summer. Polar bears are not native to Iceland, but they show up in a lot of museums, pretty much just one per museum, but they can show up in a museum dedicated to flight. They can show up in the local history museum, and they can be paired with anything, in this case, a mixer. Automobiles, motorcycles, boats, planes. There is, in fact, up in Flateri in the Vestfjords, in a town of 201 people, depending on how you count, five museums. Just think about that ratio for a minute. 201 people, five museums, six if you count the one at the edge of town, seven if you count the first museum in town from the mid-90s that was buried under an avalanche. And I suppose in some sense is still there. One of those museums is the Nonsense Museum, a collection of collections. If there's one museum that is most beloved domestically in Iceland, I think pretty much hands down, it is Petra's Stone Collection. This is a museum that exists because one woman went for a walk almost every day of her life, and on almost every walk, she came home with a stone. Now, the eastern part of Iceland is home to 3% of the population, but geologically, it's part of the oldest part of land that you can find on the island. And Germans have been coming for the obsidian for longer than the Icelanders have necessarily been all that interested in their own marvels and the variety of what can happen with that much pressure. Where these two tectonic plates abut each other, right? This island that exists because they are forcing up new land. This is a country that got a new island in the 1960s. They watch it bubble up for about a decade. Only scientists are allowed to visit as they chart how quickly life establishes itself, which for the record is pretty fast. This is the museum that's maybe the most famous outside of Iceland. The Icelandic Phallological Museum, by its own accounting, is the only museum in the world to collect a phallic specimen of every mammal native to its country. Now, a small country at the edge of the Arctic Circle does not really encourage a lot of biodiversity. If you stopped at land mammals, you would be done at the Arctic fox. It would be a very small museum indeed. But this is a museum that started out accidentally, and it's a trend. Collectors collect, but museums get pushed into being in sort of a different way. The Natural History Museum in Iceland is notable because you can't actually go in. I mean, you could if you were a scholar, if you had an appointment, if you had a reason to be there, but there's not an exhibition per se. One of the many buildings in the award-winning Herring Era Museum. You have to imagine this town that at a certain peak, the 65 years of the Herring Era, right, starting in 1903, building to a crescendo, a peak in 1967, and by 2 years later, in 1969, the whole thing just over, done, a place that was processing, at times, most of the nation's catch, this fish that has made the British Empire, the Dutch Empire, that helped bring Iceland into the economic miracle that we know it to be. So imagine a gold rush town, right? Imagine the kind of place that brought people to work, brought painters to paint, had music in the streets, was a cosmopolitan spot, and all of the industry built out to process that. And then the industry just vanished, right? Disappeared. You end up with a lot of buildings that don't have a purpose. And you end up with a lot of people that kind of feel the same way. The fire department in Siglafjordur was known in the 1970s, 1980s for being the best fire department in all of Iceland because they had so much to set on fire, to watch blaze, to burn down. And it was a place where people were embarrassed to tell you that they were from there. Until a small group of people, a few volunteers, thought it would be shameful to forget all that, to lose all of that. Mind you, these are people that had lived through the boom times. They still knew the old songs, right? They had the muscle memory of the work in their hands, but they couldn't see it anymore. They could just see the reminder of how everything had changed so quickly. And so one group of volunteers, when they were down to one of the last buildings they could possibly save, they didn't have permission, but they had enough red paint to make sure that someone could see it. And imagine what it was when the paint was fresh the first time. And then they acquired some more buildings. They acquired everything they thought they might lose. And it's only in the last 3 years, maybe, that they can catch their breath and think about what of everything that they have amassed do they really need to keep. The repurposing of buildings in Iceland is one of my favorite things. It's worth asking, what did this used to be? This is the Museum of Prophecy. It used to hold dances. It was once a municipal shed. It's had a long life. People were used to gathering there. And at some point, it became important for the town to tell its stories. One of the first named women in the sagas is from this place. They say that if you were the right kind of woman and you walk up the mountain in the right kind of way, you might find her treasure that she left buried there so that no one else would get it. There are museums that are custom built, like we were just at. Old boat, inside, it's deceptive. This is a building that is built out to hold several fishing boats. Suspended in the air, right, that you walk along docks that have no water. And a lot of museums start at home. And sometimes you don't have the thing you need, and you need to make it. I'd like to read to you one of the short essays in the book. There are these 7 long pieces that more or less think about one museum. And between them, these little cabinets, as opposed to the big galleries, these cabinets that are often about darkness and loss, a sort of minor key that runs through the book. We're going to be picking up, not quite at the end, but close. The Museum of Obligation. Samuel Jonsson was born in 1884. They say the man never had money in his hands until he retired and drew a pension. And what he did with it, immediately at age 72, was buy paint and brushes and bags of concrete because what he wanted was to make art. He painted landscapes. He sculpted figures. He painted an altarpiece and gave it to his local church. Imagine all those years, nearly a lifetime, that he sat in that little church with his private vision of what it all meant. Surely that vision evolved. Surely it was fearsome and awesome and terrible, each in turn. And then, one day, he made that vision physical, material, something separate from himself, and arrived there where he dreamt it as if returning home. Only the church didn't want it. The church would not accept. So Samuel Jonsson made his own church and erected the altarpiece there. I love this as a story of undaunted independence, of artistic freedom, of doubling down, of sticking it to the man. But there's a way of telling it that is all about obligation, a telling that is almost meek. Samuel Jonsson had made something holy, and when a holy place would not take it, he was obliged to find it some other sanctuary. The nature of the object demanded this. There could be no other way. I say church, but technically it is a chapel. It's on his farm at the end of the peninsula. The chapel is made of concrete, its architecture inspired by Russian postcards of great churches crowned with onion domes. If you've come this far down the gravel road, if you're careful, you can open the chapel's red door and let yourself inside. Indeed, Samuel Jonsson made not one, but two structures, one early and one late, the pair accompanied by a small menagerie of his painted concrete sculptures. The sculptures to be seen outside include, at more or less life size, a swan with its cygnets, a seal, a human figure feeding a seal, a human figure with its hand held up as if to wave or shield its eyes, something like a massive blue seahorse, and a semicircle of six lions radiating out like a setting sun and backed up to a white chalice of a fountain as if holding it up with their rumps, no two tails the same. After the artist made his chapel, he made a museum. He made a museum to hold the things that wouldn't hold up to the weather. He made a museum to hold the things it takes a special effort to see. The museum doesn't have hours. There's no one there on staff. The day I went, we could not get in. This is the second structure. Perhaps it is a twin. Standing there, in the shadow of the museum, between the valley and the cliff-edged coast, my companion told me about coming out here as a boy, coming out with other kids, the way the old man would show them how to add water to the fountain, like this. All those children on their tiptoes between the lions. So like the reading says, it's a gravel road to get out here. You are looking at the museum, not the church. The church you can get into, the museum you can't. And what you can see on the outside is the art that this one artist made, this man late in life who finally had the means to make the things he'd presumably been needing to make for a while. There are sort of three groups that's worth our attention right now. The makers. This is a model ship museum that's in a beautifully converted garage. And then there are the collectors. This is on the southern coast in Heimaey, on a little island off of the island. If you're trying to guess right now, I hope you are, those binders, all those stacks upon stacks, are full of napkins, paper napkins. There was a point when I was researching where I thought I'd seen a trend often enough, I had a way to predict what was going to happen next. It happened so often that someone pretty accidentally would start a museum, would start a collection, actually, just the collection. And after a while, friends would come by, family would come by, people would bring guests visiting from out of town. The local press would write something about it. Groups would come, right, stag parties and school groups and people that wanted something to see. And sort of by degree, these private collections almost tipped into becoming public museums. It's one of the most startling things that I first noticed when I was there the very first time. I've never seen anything like it. I have worked in museums in multiple states here in this country. I've been a museum visitor on four continents. I've volunteered. I've spent a lot of time thinking about collections and what they are and how they happen. And never, I had nothing to prepare me for the ease with which these private collections could slip into becoming public museums. And it's worth stopping for a moment to think about the language. Iceland uses the one word, sap, S-A-F-N, and it means collection. I was on Facebook today, and the novelist Lilja Sigurdóttir was talking about how one of her Nordic noir pieces was just picked up for a museum of stories. Right, the translation had caught collection and assumed that she must mean museum. And a lot of these places become museums in translation, that in the Icelandic they're closer to centers or exhibitions. They've got room for places that don't have long-term collections. And I think it matters. I think that if the language has already set you up, that a collection can also be a museum, that there's nothing to shift, it is always the same word, it might be a lot easier to make them. I should note that we were in a library. Libraries have the same root in them. They're collections of books. It's one of the ways you could describe a group of sheep, the same word. It's not a museum of sheep, right? It's a group of sheep, a collection. And this collector is not alone. There are usually women, usually this generation, in all sorts of parts of Iceland that did this, many of whom still have their collections. This is the museum I think might be coming next. Because I would ask back when I spotted this trend of, oh, you have a collection, people start to see it, somebody writes about it, and at some point it becomes a museum. This was a thing that I would ask every Icelander I ran into, every time I could get it worked into the conversation. Surely someone's hometown had something like this, that they could point me to the next collection just about to tip into becoming a museum. And I don't know if it's true. This is the closest I've come. This practice of, as a child, this collector will point out, there was no television, there was no radio, there wasn't a lot to do. What you could do is sort of a trick-or-treat of kinds. You would go to an event, you'd go to a house after a party and ask if they could spare some napkins, right? It's sort of like baseball trading cards. You would share them with your friends, take a few extras so that you could get something that you wanted. And this is a collection that you will never see unless you ask the right person to get the right invitation to come talk about it over the kitchen table. So you've met the makers, you've met the collectors. We should think about the exhibitionists. There are, if we were part of the International Committee of Museums, we would be thinking about the five official things a museum needs to do to earn the title. One of them is definitely to exhibit. We're looking here at the hamster specimen, the smallest specimen at the Phallological Museum. Unless you count the things, you can't actually see it all. I mentioned Petra's stone collection to you earlier. This is the legacy that we have now. If you are picking up a stone about every day, that adds up. Any one thing, right? If you were keeping coffee cups or bus tickets or picking up pennies or blades of grass, it would add up. And it's really handy if you want to have a collection, if you want to have a museum, to pick something that doesn't even need the upkeep of shelter. These rocks that come from the earth were just fine sitting out. The family has to come every spring and see what has been moved around in the snowdrifts to get the bulbs planted and make sure that the flowers will bloom. But you can start the rocks that don't fit in your home on the shelves. You can ring them around the flagpole. You can send them back up your garden in this sort of reverse avalanche. And it's worth noting, this is the sort of thing that you can see from the road. There are guides who have been taking people to see this stone collection for 40 years, who have been having coffee at the same table for 40 years. The kitchen of a two-bedroom house that once had Petra, her husband, her mother-in-law, and four children. a place that became a museum in some sense because for all of the tour buses that were arriving, all of the visitors that were coming to see this central feature of the east side of Iceland, she wouldn't charge admission until one day someone said, "Excuse me, where's the bathroom?" And the lady of the house pointed them in the right direction, and they said, "No, no, it's occupied. Isn't there another?" And there wasn't. And they said, "What kind of museum has only one bathroom?" At which point, it seemed to make sense to invest in the facilities, to let people start paying admission so that more people could come. You, in fact, can see the bathrooms off at the edge. So this is a collector famous for the stone collection, but she's like most collectors. She collected a lot of things. The rocks from the mountains down to the shore, the seashells that came out of them. She and a best friend had an annual tradition of trading handkerchiefs since they were little girls up until they had to have their children run them between their beds. She collected keychains. She collected the taxidermied birds of the area, right? This is a gannet hovering above. Collectors, you might know some. You might be one. Collectors collect. It's what they do. They collect all sorts of things, but only one or two of those collections tends to become a museum. It's the visitors that make the difference. Back when I was a manager of collections at the Museum of Contemporary Photography in Chicago, where I had my white gloves and keys to the vault, sometimes it really worried me that this was the plan. We were going to leave the entire material and intellectual history of the world to a few self-selected volunteers, right? We were already limited to just the things that survive at all, and we were going to further limit that by what people had chosen, right? What their whims had taken them to holding on to. It seemed like we might be losing, we might be missing, we might be forgetting a lot of stuff that mattered. But while I was in the stone collection, I noticed that it's not the collector's job to make the museum. We do it. It's a surprisingly grassroots democratic thing with every visit, everyone we tell, everything that we sort of push towards, every way that we affirm that this is a thing that interests us, that sparks something for us. We sort of nudge these things by thousands of little actions into being. We sort of push them all together. We are collectively selecting for the objects, the collections that tell us something we need to know. What that is can vary. This is a textile museum with the Icelandic national costume, a thing that we can date back to an inventor, right? Somebody decided what it was, and in the scheme of things, not that long ago. We will build things to tell the stories we need to. These are French fishermen waiting in one of the French hospitals that dot Iceland. In this part of the world, the Icelanders could count in French because the boats docked close enough, and as they went through the catch, the Icelanders could hear them counting. It's hard to say enough about how important it is to have an animal that can convert one of the few things that grows on this island into something you can use, right? The wool is important. The horn can be used to make a spoon, a thing that is so vital, so well made that it exists in the language. There's the idiom to hand over your spoon, meaning to die, right? The thing that you give to be inherited. Even though, if you get them hot enough, they bend. If you are a very close reader, you will note that one of these creatures from beneath the sea, from 500 meters beneath the sea, has been labeled Sputnik. I've come to think there's a genre of museum in Iceland that is the memorial museum. They don't necessarily announce themselves, but they exist because there was somebody who loved something, and they were lost too soon. And the people who knew them needed to do something with that grief and with that love. And this motorcycle museum is one of those places. I think it's worth remembering the kind of physical space Iceland is. There's a lively debate currently going, you could be a part of it, regarding whether or not there ever were trees in Iceland, or whether they existed but were cut down sort of by the first inhabitants to heat their saunas before they figured out that there was enough geothermic heat and hot water already at their disposal that they could kind of skip it. At certain points in Iceland's history, 70% of their wooden things are made with driftwood or shipwreck. This is driftwood. Mostly it gathers on the northern coast, but not entirely. Right? Wood seasoning, maybe for a decade, and the currents that bring it over from Siberia. And if you're a place that doesn't have much workable clay, much metal, and not enough wood to heat to get either of those things hot enough to work with, if you don't quite have the traditional material cultural mediums that you might recognize in other parts of the world, you've got a lot of energy that you can invest in the immaterial. This is a place that tells stories. The sagas you might be familiar with. If you ask English PhDs of a certain era, a lot of them are emeritus now, they learned Icelandic because it wasn't that Old Norse, Old English, not that different. As long as you were reading Beowulf, you might as well read the sagas. The first Icelandic language Bible, this is a thing that would have cost 3 cows. It is that much labor. And it exists in 1584. It's only the following year that the first complete map of Iceland exists, right? This is a place where language and place almost walk hand in hand. And this is a testament to the importance of a people who had their own language that they were going to use, that were then in a position to make sure that you had a tutor that came to your farm for a month every year to make sure that you could read. It's a country that achieved near universal literacy decades before anywhere else in Europe managed it. And the facility with language, the tradition of poetry, of song, the forms that are sung from one shepherd to another between valleys are old. This is a practice and an interest that today means things like 1 in 10 Icelanders will not just write, but publish a book in their lifetimes. This is a people that have an idiom for that sensation of thinking that you do need to write a book that translates as to have a book in your belly. You may be familiar that we are starting now on book flood, the sort of annual, everything is published all at once because it is so vital. It would not be Christmas if you didn't have an article of clothing and a book that you could read all night. And if you're a place that knows how to tell stories, you're really well situated to make storytelling institutions. And fundamentally, that's what museums are. Here is just a few of the guidebooks at the Stone Collection. I think we sometimes think that museums are about things, certainly that collections are about things. I enjoy this. This isn't old, but it will become old. It's from a museum that gets translated as the Sundry Museum or the Museum of Small Things. Imagine someone restoring old Icelandic houses who started keeping nails found in the walls to restore other old Icelandic houses, who was also the sort of person who had every pencil from having started school onward, who collects masses and masses of things. They're the sort of person whose community will at some point realize that act, the evidence of that act, needs to be kept. Stories attach to things. It's sort of amazing how many different stories, right? How the thing was made, how it came to be possessed. And I think we know this. I think if you look around right now at wherever you are, you will notice how many touchstones that you keep close at hand. And I want to tell you about this one in particular. This is from a museum collection. It's in a toy box. There's an old system of Icelandic toys that's very regular, mostly made out of sheep bones. Remember how important those sheep are. So that the jawbone can be tapped into the earth to graze like a cow. You can have a longer limb bone to trot along as a horse. The horn of the sheep represents the sheep. But if you're going to have all of those shell or those horned sheep, you're going to need a dog to take care of them. The shell is the dog. This museum in the basement of a hotel that used to be a boarding school keeps all of the old toys to show, but they make sure that they keep restocking the shells because sometimes a very curious child asks very good questions, and they are rewarded by getting to take home a dog. I did not know how to declare this at customs. Like I said, I think it's easy to think of museums as being places about things, about stuff. But you scratch the surface, and you'll notice all of the stories. When I worked in museums, it really used to concern me that we were generating stories like you wouldn't believe. We interacted with the public, and we had a bunch of interesting stuff that no one ever got to look at. We were burdened with stories, and there was no one there to make sure that we held on to those. This urge to exhibit, to collect the place and the story, the thing and the story, has a long history in Iceland. I like these places where the marker, not even a full museum, not a full exhibition, just these visual reminders trying to connect what is here to what has been. In the 70s, the island of Heimaey, its volcano erupted in the middle of the night, and they got everyone off, including the napkin collector you met earlier, eventually the napkin collection. And so they have the pictures. Part of the town is still underneath all of that lava flow, but they can let you know what it was like in the 70s to experience the place where you were standing in that moment. Ditto with the geology. And sometimes it is not even connecting the thing and the language, it is the language itself. This is a book downtown spread open. And this is a specimen of something that you can't see. The Icelanders are sort of astonishingly good at representing the things you can't see. It strikes me as a very Icelandic problem. And if you pay attention in the landscape, the way that the mist goes through, the fact that seeing the northern lights is not so much an issue of whether or not they're happening as your ability to get past the cloud cover to witness them. There's a lot of reasons why you would be particularly in touch with what you can see and what is there anyway. What was the Sea Monster Museum going to show you? I mean, think about it. What were they going to show you? They have stuff. They could be, if they chose, if they wanted to change their name, they could identify as a maritime museum, as a local history museum, as a natural history museum. But what they are is something so rare you maybe have never heard of it. They are an oral history museum. They have 4,000 oral histories collected, and they aren't done yet. It started with a newspaper reporter or a radio reporter who had some time at the station, you know, sort of odd hours, and looked at a map of Iceland, a place that's inhabited totally along the edges, right? Sheep maybe live in the middle in the highlands, but otherwise the weather's just too bad. There's no reason to do it. So you can work it, right, like the edges of a clock. And trace your way around the country calling every retirement home to see if somebody has a story. And pretty often, they did. This is a country where, I don't know, maybe every other person wouldn't mind telling you about a personal encounter with a ghost. But monster stories are different. Monster stories have a taboo. The Museum of Witchcraft and Sorcery is in kind of a similar position. They have an important history, but what were they going to show you? They can detail the genealogy of connections within towns, of why you might accuse someone of witchcraft, because after they were gone, you might stand to benefit from their property. They can create things to give you a sense of the desire that was being harnessed in magic. But by its nature, the written magic, right, these handwritten grimoires, because it was illegal to have, certainly wouldn't have been printed, were burned when they were found. They were hidden. They were mostly lost to us. We know about a score of them now. So this is a place that is sort of liberated. If you can't have stuff, or you're really limited in what is left to show, to tell the stories that you need to tell, you get to make the things, right? You get to invent the things. You get to create the object that can hold the thing that we need to hear. You might not notice there is a corpse arising from the center of this room. You might not notice the scorn pole in the corner. You might not notice in this mere glance how much of witchcraft and sorcery in Iceland is about trying to figure out or trying to prevent theft, right? Not even trying to get rich, just trying to keep what you have. And a little trying to get rich, and a little making people love each other. But mostly, just trying to be okay. But the sort of place where you might enchant a rib found in a graveyard, dug up and wrapped with twine and the right things said, so that your rib baby would do your bidding. And your bidding is just that it steal cream from the neighbors so your children can eat. As objects go, ancient waffle irons are pretty great. And similar to the current ones, they still have those five hearts all in the center. A reminder that even when you think it's about the thing, the label tells you, this is a few kinds of ancient waffle irons. Really, beyond that, there are so many other stories that need to be told about why we still have it, what it was used for in the first place, and what might happen next. These are the barrel stencils for processing all the herring. Glimpses at the many birds. Here we're in a back room in an old shed used to monitor seismographic activity, repurposed to house the most complete private collection of birds on the island. Notably, a collection whose mission shifts over time as the climate changes and what birds are in Iceland is not as set a thing as you might imagine. I can't explain all of these pulleys to you. And in some sense, I can't explain the accordions either. This is a memorial set with the jawbones of whales to remember what's known as the slaughter of the Spaniards. A little more than 400 years ago, the only mass murder in Icelandic history, a story of poverty. Again, the Icelanders for a long time weren't whalers. That was a thing that foreign nations did. They would come and they would trade some stuff. They usually had good terms. They might give you the smaller whales. Iceland is a country that has a phrase that means, right, to try to wish you good luck is hvlareki, may a whale get stranded on your beach. So if you have a certain period of time where the whalers are interacting or making their deals with the Icelanders, the Danish king who's in charge at some point is going to want to cut and make it so that you can't trade with them, but you can murder them and take their things. And if those Basque sailors are a little late in the season, if a bad enough storm comes and knocks their boats into each other in the harbor so that they sink and have to escape on longboats, some of them, we won't know what happens to. They will go farther than our memories. But one of them and his crew, Captain Villafranca, will be lost to people that were desperate. So our tour is coming to an end. There are a lot of places to go, a lot of things to talk about. I understand you have the ability to send in questions. Please do. I've got a few more things to show you about this place that we're going to spend a little more time with this evening. I want you to remember that this is a place that exists because of particular conditions. These are children's renderings of volcanoes on an island that lost part of town because one erupted in the middle of the night. This returns you to Samuel Janssen's farm and finally having the opportunity to make the things that need to be made, to start with a church and then realize you need a museum too. The herring era, now in five, maybe I think just recently six buildings plus a giant oil drum that has been fit to with a door. They had to cut one out so that you can go inside and maybe a teenager will play you an accordion. Maybe the local band will come. Maybe a traveling band will come and the notes will be clear yet reverberating. I'm going to take you behind the scenes. I'm going to give you the best guides I've been able to find. And encounters that maybe you wouldn't have had on your own when you thought about what could be in an Icelandic museum. I feel it's important to notice that Toti is a living bird who walks around the aquarium, or did until recently, was born too late in the season to make it on his own. And so, lives in a museum. Let's go to where your questions take us.
Thank you, Kendra. That was wonderful. Do they have underground hotel rooms in Iceland?
Tom, that's a great question. Partly, I think it depends on how you define underground. It sounds to me like a question that's maybe thinking about caves and tunnels and spots under glaciers. But it makes me think about the old traditional turf houses, right? Remember, a place that doesn't have a lot of lumber to spare is the kind of place that will figure out how to cut the earth, right? The sod in four different ways to be used as different building materials. And for a long time, live in the sod houses. People were still living in them in the 70s. These places that they say, if you don't give them constant attention, will on their own return to the earth in 4 years.
The next question is, what evidence of climate change did you observe, and how were the Icelanders coping with it?
The Icelanders are very aware of the science. They are very aware that their government needs to do things, and they're very aware that they are a tiny place that is going to need more nations and more people to do their part too. You notice it in a few things, museum-wise speaking. We talked about the phallological museum that has a mission to collect every mammal species native to that country. The curator is still alive, and in the, I think, 40 years since the collection started, it's been enough for the ocean currents to change, and whales that used to be seen are seen not at all now, and there are new species arriving. I introduced you just at the end. We can go back to Toti. On the island of Heimaey, on the southern coast, if you were a person in my generation or older, you would have had a ritual as kids, you would have gone out for basically a month in August after sundown to go see which pufflings had failed to tumble out of their nests down the cliffs into the water, which had instead, because these are very steep, sharp cliffs, sometimes the wind comes back up and the puffling that is trying to escape the nest gets blown back and sees the lights of town and walks towards them. So there was, for a long time, a practice of taking a box, scooping them up, waiting until day, and then flinging them back out where they were supposed to be. They say it's down to a day or two now. There are people the age of my older sister who can tell you about when the phalaropes would come, right? One of those sky-darkening avian events. And it doesn't happen now.
Thank you for joining us tonight. We're going to show you a slide where you can buy her book on and get a more detailed experience, not only from somebody who's been there, but also a very good writer. So thank you so much for joining us tonight. This is where you can go to her site and buy the book. And we'll see you a week from Friday night. Thank you for joining us.